thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here, and I already feel at home in the company of Phoolbhai, Mohanty, Sindhuji. These are all friends and colleagues. I've lived with them. So please do not take all that Professor Singh Phoolbhai says, take it with a pinch of salt. He's saying it out of his affection for me. And people can become somewhat subjective in their affection. But thank you very much. It feels very nice. I'm very grateful for this opportunity to speak on Jawaharlal Nehru, his contribution to nation building. Now, friends, it is some kind of a challenge to speak on Nehru, because generally we feel that all that needs to be said has already been said and written on Nehru. Everything worth saying has been said, which is obviously not true. The more I read Nehru, the more you will read Nehru, you will discover that there are many new facets of Nehru that are waiting to be unraveled. Now, as Phoolbhai said, Nehru has for some time been the academia's and the establishment's favorite whipping boy. I think he used a wonderful word, defamation. It's not criticism, it's defamation. We are particularly going through a phase of Nehru bashing, a kind of Nehru bashing. He's being blamed for everything that has gone wrong with Indian politics and society. The slow pace of economic development till 1991, when we picked up as a result of new economic policies. So the slow pace till then, relations with Pakistan, China war of 1962, Kashmir question that we have, the policy of non-alignment, which led to all the superpowers being angry with us. So America was very angry and the Russia was angry. The limitations of our democracy, the problems with our secularism, the problems with our nationalism, you have it. In short, whatever can be considered to be a problem with India politically, there is a culprit for it. And the culprit is Jawaharlal Nehru. Now, I have an explanation for this. And before I talk about his contribution, let me give you my explanation. For this round of Nehru bashing that we are going through, or for defamation actually. It is this. Nehru was at the helm of affairs during two crucial phases of Indian history. He was both, as B.R. Nanda said, he was a rebel for some time and then he was a statesman. He performed both these roles. During the active period of the freedom struggle, let us say from 1920 till 1947, he was at the helm of affairs, leading this struggle along with Gandhi, in the company of Patel, Maulana Azad, Rajendra Prasad, Subhash Bose and others. He was one in the company of these people, all of them broadly under the leadership of Mahatma Gandhi. And then he was also at the helm of affairs in the first two extremely crucial decades after independence. He was involved with policy making. Nehru, more than anyone else, was the leader of the second phase from 1947 and the two decades after that. By this time, you know, Gandhi was gone, Patel was not there, some leaders moved away from Congress, communists moved away, socialists moved away, Rajagopalachari moved away. So people began to chip away, both from the left and from the right. Now, during the first phase, the phase of the freedom struggle, the blueprint for India's social transformation was being prepared. Tremendous energies were being generated. And there was a kind of optimism. The 40s had that optimism. And during the second phase after independence, particularly after the 70s, after emergency, if things did not go as anticipated, as expected, there was just one person to blame, Jawaharlal Nehru. So because he was at the helm of affairs during these very crucial phases of India's history in the 20th century. Now my job today is not to defend Nehru. I hope Mohanty will call me another day for that. From the blame. But only to say that some of the blame is misplaced, clearly. Some of the blame is a misreading of the situation. And some of it is also politically motivated. So we need to sift and sort the misplaced blame, the blame based on a wrong reading of the situation and quite clearly motivated blame. Anyway, my job today in about 45 to 50 minutes is to discuss Nehru's role in nation building. And for the sake of clarity and brevity, I have listed six such contributions. So I'll talk about six things. The advantage of these six things is that when I come to five, you know that the lecture is going to be over. So the long wait is over. I'll actually do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six contributions I have listed. Six contributions of Jawaharlal Nehru to nation building. One, Nehru provided a social content to Indian nationalism. And he did it by introducing the question of class to the debate on nationalism. And Nehru was the first to do it. He was the first. Let me explain what is the story. You see, sometimes from the second half of the 19th century onwards, a nation of Indian people began to grow. But this nation, Indian nation if you like, or Indian nation in making, because it's still in the process. Now this nation was more of an abstraction. It was a shell, you know, the shell, the form, without a content. It was a shell without any clear substance in it. Now Nehru provides the substance by raising two crucial questions. What are the two crucial questions? He raised it in the late 20s and early 1930s. First question that he raised was the meaning of freedom. What is the meaning of freedom? We are all fighting for independence, political independence, but what does it mean? What does independence mean? Does it mean the Indianization of the existing structure? Or does it mean a fight for a different structure altogether? Nehru said, what happens if the British people go and are replaced by the Indians? Is everything going to be okay? And his answer was no. We are not fighting for the Indianization of the existing structure. We are fighting for a different structure altogether. So, what is the meaning of freedom? Nehru asked this question. The second question he asked was, freedom for whom? For the peasant or for the landlord? In other words, he brought the question of class into nationalism. In other words, what would be the class content of independence? Who would benefit by independence? Would everybody benefit equally? Would the peasants and the landlords benefit equally? Is that possible? Would the workers and the capitalists benefit equally? Is that possible? And Nehru said no. So we must find out, we must raise the question, independence for whom? All Indians, Nehru said, we are all Indians, but we are also divided into an oppressor and an oppressed. Within India, there is a class of oppressors. Our independence cannot be for the Indian oppressors, even as we are fighting the foreign oppressor. Now, this was an extremely complex question. I've put it very simply, but a very complex question. It has been a dilemma for nationalists the world over, either during national movements or even otherwise. The dilemma is, within a nation which is supposed to be an undifferentiated, seamless collectivity, but within the nation, there are the predators and the prey. Within the nation, there is a tiny elite which feeds. There is a tiny parasitic elite which feeds on the rest. So, what should you do? Should you allow this in the name of the nation or should you question it? Now, Nehru began, so it's a difficult question for nationalists the world over. Now, Nehru began engaging with this question in a very creative manner since the 1930s. I would not say that he found the correct answer, but he began raising this question very critically. Now, this tension between the elite and the non-elite, between the workers and the industrialists, between the landlords and the peasants, this obviously could not be easily resolved. But these questions and these engagements that Nehru initiated, they enriched the politics of Indian nationalism. And Nehru played a very important role in this. As I said, he was the first to begin taking up this question, more than anyone else. So first major contribution was by providing the substance to Indian nationalism, to the shell of Indian nationalism. Second contribution that Nehru made was by internationalizing Indian nationalism. How did he do it? How did he internationalize Indian nationalism? Nehru did it by maintaining that the British rule that Indians were fighting till 1947, this British rule was part of a global system of imperialism. It was not simply British imperialism. There is something called a global system of imperialism in which there is an alliance of all the imperialist powers. They are all united. You cannot fight one particular imperialist power till you fight imperialism as a system. So Nehru began arguing systematically since the 1930s that we cannot get rid of the British rule till all of us put together weaken the very system of imperialism. Because each imperialist power, whether it's America, Japan, England, France, all of them derive their strength from this system of imperialism. So till we attack that system of imperialism, no individual imperialism can really be defeated or eliminated. In that sense, he said, India's nationalist struggle is an integral part of the global struggle against imperialism. So till there is a global struggle against imperialism, India's struggle in isolation will not be successful. And by the way, it turned out to be true, because after 1942-45, after the World War was over, in the next 15 years, 120 colonies of the world became independent. It was not simply a coincidence. It was because the World War defeated one system of imperialism. It, of course, started another system of imperialism of America and Russia, but that's a different story altogether. Since the 1930s, Nehru took up a very clear position on questions of fascism. His opposition to fascism was absolutely categorical. He supported the Spanish Civil War. He supported the Chinese people's struggle against Japanese imperialism since the 1930s. And he did it from the vantage point of Indian nationalism. So he said, as an Indian nationalist, I support the Spanish people's and the Chinese people's struggle, and I am completely opposed to fascism. In early 1947, the year India became free, but before India became free, Nehru organized a conference of all Asian countries in India, in Delhi. This was the time when the Cold War had just about begun in Europe. India was still a colony, but India was the first colony. Nehru said, we will have a conference of all the Asian countries. And both he and Gandhi made very important speeches there. Nehru said that gone are the days when we looked up to European powers. That relationship must end. We, the people of Asia, we have an older history. We must find our own voice in the affairs of the world. Gandhi, I think, said, Gandhi made this one-line speech. He said, I refuse to live in a world which is not one. So the world has to be one, but accept that the major impulses for this one world will not come from Europe. They'll now come from elsewhere. So we will still not have different worlds. It'll be one world, but it'll be a world in which Asia and the people of Asia will find their own voice and their own destiny. Now, these kinds of concerns, they fed into the non-aligned movement, about which you may have heard something. Today, as again Phoolbhai said, this has become a kind of an obsolete word, almost a bad word. But many things get blamed onto non-alignment. But I think one major contribution of non-alignment was that it effectively prevented an attempt at a recolonization of the world. And mark my word, non-alignment, whatever its other failures were, and there were many, it effectively prevented a recolonization of the world after the Second World War. There are any number of instances from the 1950s which suggest that the old colonial powers, you know, your England's and your France's and even so on, they had still not given up their dreams of domination. The Suez crisis and multiple other crises, they had still not given up. There were these sores and the wounds. They were nursing their wounds, but there was this great desire to get back into a dominant position, to get back into some kind of a recolonization. Now, non-alignment, it stood like a very effective bulwark against any such attempts at a recolonization. So the old kind of colonialism, the French and the British and so on, and the Dutch, that could not come back. And I think one major factor there was that there was this solid block against the backdrop of Cold War. There was this solid block of non-alignment, however weak, but it was very important. So the second major contribution was that Nehru, while focusing attention on Indian nationalism, constantly internationalized Indian nationalism. He made Indian nationalism more and more outward rather than inward. His constant question was, India has a great role to play in the affairs of the world. What role will India play? Now that's a nationalist question. What role will India play? But what role will India play where? At the international arena. And Nehru played a very important role as the representative of the Indian people. So Nehru internationalized Indian nationalism. The third major contribution that Nehru made was by ridding Indian economy of all vestiges of colonialism. By ridding Indian economy of all vestiges of colonialism. You see, we became independent in 1947. But independence did not automatically mean the end of colonialism from the Indian economy. You see, there are vested interests, there are capitalists, there is capital, there is technology, there are institutions, infrastructure, some of it created by the colonial rulers. A lot of that does not simply go away. 2 centuries of colonial rule, 2 centuries of colonization of Indian economy had created shackles. Some economists say that colonialism creates a depressor. It depresses the Indian economy, it depresses the economy of the colony and affects its capacity to function independently for the next few decades also. 2 centuries of colonialism had created shackles or depressors for Indian economy. Now, it had to be unshackled. Indian economy had to be completely rid from the vestiges of colonialism. The challenge was, precisely, I want you to understand and appreciate, the challenge was how to build a modern independent economy from a very small base. By the way, the country was very large, but if you look at the size of economy, it was really very, very small. Even in the second plan, the total amount was something like 8,000 crores or 9,000 crores. You know, that was the amount we were playing around with. It was a very small economy in 1947. Big country, small economy. The challenge was how to build a modern independent economy from a very small base without depending on foreign help. One natural option was to depend on foreign help. Either capital or technology or machinery or whatever, without depending on foreign help and within a parliamentary democratic framework. Now, these two things are very important. I'll explain. There are these two pitfalls which had to be avoided. What is the first pitfall? The first pitfall is, let me call it the Japan, South Korea, China pitfall. In which you achieve economic development within an authoritarian or a semi-authoritarian structure. That's the South Korea model, in which you compromise with your democracy a little bit. The other model is a Latin American model, in which you develop economically, but you develop through foreign help, dependence on foreign capital and technology and so on. Now, in the first model, the South Korean model, you compromise your democracy. In the second model, you compromise your sovereignty, national sovereignty. For a colony, the fear of being recolonized not necessarily by England, but by some other power. That fear is always there. The task was quite unprecedented. How to develop a modern independent economy without either dependence on foreign capital or foreign countries, and while remaining your parliamentary democratic structure, well within the parliamentary democratic structure. Don't compromise on either of them. That would slow down your economy, but this was the task. The task was quite unprecedented. No model really existed for this. What Nehru did in the 40s and the 50s, that actually became a kind of a model. As the leading economist, Sukumar Chakravarti, he's one of the best we have, he once wrote that development theory of that time for the non-European world, development theory and Indian development practice under Nehru, they became dialectically related. So theory was saying one thing, and Nehru was actually doing, and without really borrowing from the theory, but the two were happening simultaneously. Nehru was actually creating a practice which was being theorized upon, which could be built into a model. Otherwise, no model existed for this. It was completely unprecedented to grow an economy, to develop an economy within a parliamentary democratic framework. If there are questions on this, I would be very happy to elaborate this point further. The fourth contribution of Nehru to nation building was land reforms with democracy. Immediately after independence, this happened. Nehru said that everything can wait, agriculture cannot wait. So first, one of the earliest tasks that were done by independent Indian state was the dismantling of landlordism from agriculture. Immediately after independence, Nehru implemented land reforms, but with democracy. What that meant was that without too much coercion or without too much violence. And it was a huge task. 300 million acres. It required a change in the ownership pattern of 300 million acres of land. To just give you a sense of how big the task was. India is no small country. It's a huge country. It was one-fifth of the world. To be precise, we must get the right proportion, right? We must understand the situation with precision. It did not mean land redistribution. That is not what was attempted. What was attempted was, it meant dismantling of feudalism from Indian agriculture. The abolition of the artificial system of landlordism created by the British. It was not a carryover from Indian tradition. The system under the Mughals was very different, Tanuja will probably tell you. Under the British, a new system of landlordism was created. And what Nehru after 1947 did was, Indian government, Indian system, there was complete unanimity on that. Nehru was not the only one. What did was to dismantle this structure of feudalism from Indian agriculture. What did it mean? It meant that the ownership of land now went to 20 million tenants who had been cultivating the land without any ownership rights. Some of them were vulnerable, some of them could be evicted, some of them would have to pay very extra rents, etc. to the landlord and so on. Some of them would have to put up with the bad behavior of the landlord, etc. All that went. The 20 million tenants became, at one stroke of pen, landowners of the land that they had been cultivating. These were the peasant caste. So if you want to know, when did the OBC revolution begin? The OBC revolution actually began here. The first phase in 1947-48, when these tenants effectively got ownership rights over the land that they had been cultivated. Now, it is also important to recognize that it is this class, the erstwhile tenants, but the new landlords, it is this class that played a very leading role in bringing about the Green Revolution 2 decades later. In Punjab, in Andhra, in West UP, Maharashtra, it was this class which actually became a building block in the Green Revolution that happened. Green Revolution made India self-reliant in food in the 70s. Till 1970s, India was an importer of food every year, year after year. India would pay for it with whatever the small amount was. India, there would be problems in evolving an independent foreign policy because your arm could be twisted. In the 60s, America could twist your arm by asking you to have a particular kind of policy vis-a-vis Israel or West Asia. And if you don't do it, then there is trouble at home. If there is a bad year, bad crop, your PL 480, under PL 480, public law 480, your rice may not come. It was the Green Revolution which made India self-reliant in food. It ended the begging bowl image. India by that time had a begging bowl image from ship to mouth. It used to be said that Indian people live from ship to mouth. They wait for food and it comes from ship and goes straight to mouth. And it also affected, it had also affected India's foreign policy. So much of the, what happened under Green Revolution, I think much of the groundwork for that had already been made in the late 40s and 1940s and 1950s by altering the very structure of Indian agriculture under this scheme of dismantling feudalism. There is a leading scholar, Daniel Thorner, who's an India expert, was an India expert. He said, and I think it's a very important point, he said much more was done in the first 25 years after independence than in the last two centuries to Indian agriculture. So he's saying much more happened to Indian agriculture in the first 25 years after independence than the previous two centuries. The entire structure of Indian agriculture was actually transformed and overhauled. So that is the next major contribution that Nehru made to nation building. The fifth contribution of Nehru to nation building was, and here I think I'm using Nehru along with others. You see, Nehru was very active at a period when he worked in close partnership with many people. So sometimes it becomes difficult to separate Nehru from the other. The idea is not to exaggerate Nehru's role. Idea is to put it in perspective. So Nehru did many things and he was in company. He was doing it. He was the head of the state or a leader of the movement and so on. So Nehru and others also spent considerable energy in creating institutions which became the software of Indian nation. Now, Indian nation has a hardware, the visible manifestations, but there is also a software of Indian nation, which also keeps the nation together, which also plays a role, which also provides energy and vitality to the Indian nation. Let me give you two or three examples of this. Nehru drafted the famous 1931 Karachi Resolution. It's a very famous document, Karachi Resolution. Just Google and you'll get the entire thing, two-page document. This resolution, which is a kind of a blueprint for India's social transformation. Now, it's very interesting. This Karachi Resolution was drafted by Jawaharlal Nehru. It was placed at the open session by Gandhi and it was presided over by Sardar Patel. So Patel presided over a Congress session. He was the president of Congress in which Nehru drafted a very famous resolution. And Gandhi, even though he did not agree with some of the provisions of the Karachi resolution because it was about centralization and so on, but Gandhi actually moved it. So I'm also trying to give you a sense of the kind of partnership and synergy that existed among the leaders then. Nehru drafted the 1931 Karachi resolution. That's important. Secondly, he was also the leader behind creating a civil liberties union in 1936. This was to be a non-party organization, but he felt that as Indian society was developing, it was important for India to have a civil liberties union. India was a colony, mind you, then. It was not an independent country. It did not have state power. There was a national movement going on. Quite often, leaders of protest movements are very wary about civil liberties issues because they can be accused of it. And yet, Nehru was very keen that a civil liberties frame should be there. He took the initiative in 1936 and created a civil liberties union in 1936 as the leader of a movement. This was to be a non-party organization. It was not done under Congress. Nehru also initiated, he was also very keen on a planning committee, a group of people, an institution that would go into the question of allocation of resources, financial resources and so on. So as early as 1938, again, India is still not independent, it's a colony, a planning committee was formed, Nehru along with Subhash Bose, and it was this planning committee which subsequently became a planning commission, and the Prime Minister was its chairman. So tremendous importance was given to this. Nehru also anticipated the knowledge revolution when after India became free in the 50s, and he created institutions for it in the 1950s. Massive investments were made in science and technology. Now these investments paid dividends decades later. After Nehru was dead and gone, he was there only to be blamed. Decades later, particularly in the IT sector and in nuclear technology. You see, these kind of investments in science and technology institutions, they take time to mature. It's almost like planting a tree. But it's important to recognize that the tree was planted in 1950s by Nehru. And he anticipated a knowledge revolution. By that time, there was not so much of talk about it. I want to make two points here. First, of course, in fact, there is a genuine criticism of Nehru, genuine as against the fake defamation. I'm not talking about that. The genuine criticism of that of Nehru is that he neglected primary education and also social sciences. He neglected primary education. He felt that willpower was enough. He did not create enough of an investment into it. And our record in there in literacy, primary education, compared to the other giant, China, is obviously not at all impressive. I think the investments were low there. With finite resources, there is always this pressure about where to invest. Nehru was very keen on investing it in science and technology, creating institutions. He also did not pay enough attention to the social sciences. He felt that social sciences are okay, they can take care of themselves, but science requires all the infrastructure and investment, etc. I feel that something like JNU should have been set up in the 1950s. JNU was created as a national institution. The idea was that India should not really be borrowing concepts and ideas and scholarship from the developed country. India should generate its own sociology, its own knowledge systems, its own concept, which would be rooted in Indian philosophical traditions, Indian philosophy, Indian knowledge systems. That was the idea behind JNU. But I think JNU came one decade later. It should have, well, it came later, let's say. In literacy, as you know, we are still to catch up with China. The other point that I need to make in this context is that in the knowledge sector, in the investments that Nehru made in anticipating a knowledge revolution, in the knowledge sector, because other sectors of economy did not simultaneously develop, there was a kind of a brain drain that started since the 1960s. Quite clearly, it started. The best minds started moving away. I have a story of our JNU teacher, Professor Aditya Mukherjee. He was meeting an IIT professor and they had a talk. And the IIT professor said with a great deal of pride, he said, "My batch is very good. It consists of very bright people. They are all doing very well. This time, all of them got jobs and they've gone abroad. They've gone to Europe and America." This was being stated as a great achievement of the institution. Now, it is at an individual level, it is an achievement. But what's happening is that a lot of the resources, a lot of the investments are going into creating minds, which are not then staying here and going away. This is not to blame anyone. Let me say something. It's just because other sectors of economy, infrastructure and so on, have not really picked up. So when that does not happen, you can create an engineer, but if you cannot absorb and employ him, he might want to go somewhere else. You can have a very good doctor and you can ask that good doctor to go to the village, but if your infrastructure has not picked up in the villages, etc., then the doctor might think twice. So my thing is that there is a kind of an imbalance. Merely development in one sector and no corresponding development in another sector, it creates distortions of a very, very different kinds. Our brain drain was a distortion of one such kind. But what is the importance of this brain drain? What's wrong after all if people go? Let me say that something on that. Let me say something which will easily explain to you the importance of brain drain, and also it will explain to you why Europe, if you ask this question to yourself, why Europe has had an early advantage in the last two or three centuries. Why is it that the big breakthrough, the big revolution happened in England or Europe and not in China, not in India, and not in some other country? It could well have happened. We know that till the 15th century, it was a flat world. All the countries were more or less at par with each other. There was nothing, you could not predict that the big breakthrough will happen. If at all it happens, it will happen in one European country. You see, there are four key factors of production in modern economy. Land, labor, capital, and knowledge. Land, labor, capital, and knowledge. Growth cannot happen through willpower. There are these four factors which are important. Now, the first three of these, land, labor, and capital, that came to Europe in abundance from outside. Where did the land come from? Remember your school textbooks. Land came through discoveries. America was discovered, Australia was discovered, and these became a kind of natural extensions of Europe. So land was an important factor, land was discovered. Labor was an important factor, labor came from Africa, from western part of Africa. 13 million black slaves, the slaves came from Africa, 13 million slaves traveled and came, and out of those 3 million died. But over a period of two centuries, 13 million slaves from Africa traveled to feed into the economy whose center was in Europe. 3 million died, but 10 million. But that in any case altered the profile of countries like America. Capital came from Asia, from the colonies. You've heard words like tribute. The medieval rulers used to use the word tribute. Even the colonial rulers called it tribute. Indian nationalists did not like the word tribute. They said drain of wealth. They said it's drain of wealth. Economists began talking about remittances. But whether you call it tribute or you call it drain or you call it remittance, it's all the same thing. Tremendous wealth, capital going from one country to feed into the economic development, to become investable capital and feed into the economic development of another country. So all the factors of modern production, in that Europe had an advantage. Land, labor, and capital. And this advantage came from elsewhere. Except, of course, they developed their own knowledge systems. But now, even that, the brain drain means that even the knowledge which rests on technology and science and so, even that's going. So if you put it in this perspective, then you can see the importance, the negative importance for us of brain drain. Nehru anticipated it, but he obviously was not able to succeed. He could not anticipate the brain drain. Why did Nehru not succeed? Well, I think there are two reasons for it. First, of course, is what I just told you. Other sectors of economy did not simultaneously grow. So how to send your doctor to a village without an infrastructure, it's not enough to just create engineers. One has to employ them and absorb them. So other things have got to be happening in economy. Second important reason, of course, is, and that's something which will automatically appeal to you, modern global capitalism does not always operate through coercion. It does not always use force. Often it operates through a social bribery network, social bribery mechanism. It bribes you, it tempts you, it dazzles you, and it bribes you. It just sucks whoever it needs into the system by luring, by tempting, by bribing them. Plenty of that happens within the country. So for better jobs, there's more money, more people are attracted. But it also happens outside. People are attracted to the capitalist countries because of the dazzle, because of the social bribery mechanism network. They have it. As long as this happens, obviously brain drain will keep happening, and it will, we cannot really complain about it. But nonetheless, the point here was to recognize the kind of contribution that Jawaharlal Nehru made towards creating institutions, towards having a net effective establishment of science and technology. The results of that became clear in decades' time, in the 80s and 90s, with IT and with nuclear technology. The tree had been planted in the 50s, and Nehru did the planting of the tree. And finally, sixthly, so I'm now, next 5 or 10 minutes, I'll actually wind up. Sixthly, sixth point, sixth major contribution that I think Nehru made towards nation building was that he contributed to the making of Indian nation as it is and as it ought to be by integrating and combining three things: socialism, secularism, democracy. Now, all these three desirable values. We want socialism, as a kind of welfare. Socialism can be a very debatable point, but I am using socialism more in the sense of welfare of the people. Socialism, secularism, and democracy. We might want all three of them, but sometimes the exact combination may not be easy to achieve. Nehru instituted socialism as a dominant idea amongst the Indian people. He was actually one of the first, globally speaking, he was the first, one of the first to break away from Stalinist Marxism. He argued that effective and lasting socialist transformation will come not through insurrection, not the Russian way or the Chinese way, not the Bolshevik way or the Chinese way, but effective and lasting socialist transformation will come with popular backing, when people will do it, when people will bring it about. In other words, effective and lasting socialism will come only through democracy, democratic mandate. Then it will last, otherwise it will not last. He called it, he gave it a term, socialism of the 95%. So only when a large majority of people is convinced about the idea, then it will be a viable, stable, and a lasting solution. But a tiny microscopic minority, even of the best minds, will not be able to bring it about, as happened in both the, in other countries of the world. On this, there was a very stimulating debate that Jawaharlal Nehru had with Chou Enlai, Chinese premier, in 1956, end of 56, he was here. I have it with me. There are about 30 pages. I would request that this be photocopied and circulated. Nehru's making a point, Chou Enlai making a point. They're actually sitting together. There are three sessions of meeting, and they are talking about everything: communism, nationalism, Hungary, USSR, America, and so on. It's one of the most fascinating debates. And if you really want to have a sense of how Nehru's mind was working as against Chou Enlai, I think those 30 pages would be very, very useful. He always highlighted socialism's link with democracy. And he constantly said this to Chou Enlai, that socialism will only succeed when it combines with nationalism. What is nationalism? It's consensus and homogenization. So if there is a consensus, nationalist consensus, then you can have socialism. Chou Enlai is constantly talking about socialism versus nationalism. And Nehru is always saying that socialism will be strong only if it's backed up by a nationalist consensus. Please read it. I would like this to be circulated. Likewise, so it's a new twist on socialism completely. Likewise, he argued that for a country like India, true democracy can only be secular. So he's just kind of establishing connections. It should involve equal participation of all sections and communities without any discrimination, which is what secularism in the end turn is there in the Indian usage. Likewise, secularism as an idea, as an aspiration, as something that we want, it can survive only under democratic conditions. It cannot survive. A tiny cosmopolitan elite cannot institute secularism in this country. It can be instituted when people by and large want it. And they, whichever way they understand secularism, they may have a different understanding of secularism, not the scientific temper kind of understanding, but it'll have to, the energies for secularism will have to come from the people, not from the cosmopolitan tiny elite. In fact, again, there is some bit of criticism because Phool Bhai said that we should need to also look at Nehru in a critical manner. In fact, so convinced was Nehru of this idea that he did not anticipate, and he did not write about it, he did not anticipate a situation in which the democratic mandate will go against the secular impulses. And when that happens, what do you do? This is called the, let me give it a name, this is called the Turkish dilemma. What is Turkish dilemma? You see, in Turkey, after Kemalist revolution, the tiny elite, the small elite in Turkey has been constantly engaging with a question. They want democracy and they also want secularism. So the military elite holds on to secularism by withdrawing democracy. Because the fear is that if you open the society to democracy, then all kinds of obscurantist people and all kinds of fundamentalists will hijack democracy. So they withdraw democracy and they institute secularism. After a while, they open the society to democracy. When they open the society to democracy, then the idea of secularism goes, because all kinds of obscurantists and characters, they hijack democracy. They are not able to have both secularism and democracy at the same time. They hold on to secularism, democracy goes. They open out to democracy, then their secularism goes. It's not easy to have this precise kind of a combination. Now, when you do not have this combination, what should you do? When you have the Turkish dilemma, let's say, then what should you do? India in the 1940s, when the demand for Pakistan, which Nehru was completely opposed to, but Nehru was completely helpless and clueless when he discovered that more and more support was gathering for this idea. India in the 1940s, United States of America now, people are now realizing that they do not know what happens when something which you might be unacceptable, but it has a lot of democratic support and mandate. And you can think of many other similar situations. I will not name them. Nehru actually did not write about it. Nehru assumed the desirability of this combination of secularism and democracy. But what happens when this exact combination is not available to you? In other words, what happens when you have a Turkish dilemma? Nehru actually did not write very much about it. And he did not write very much about it. We don't seem to know very much about it. Nehru did not develop any thoughts in this direction. And we are still clueless. We are there. So where Nehru failed, we also remain failed as intellectuals, as thinking people. At the level of thought, we do not seem to have gone beyond Nehru very much. We have not developed him. We should. It's time that we should. To sum up now, I have highlighted 6 ways in which Nehru contributed to the nation building. Let me just remind you. 1, by providing the social substance to the shell or the idea of Indian nationalism, by bringing the caste question into it. Class question into it. 2, by highlighting the international dimension of Indian nationalism by projecting a nationalism that was outward rather than inward. 3, by purging Indian economy of vestiges of colonialism. Economic development with sovereignty, without compromising on sovereignty, but and also within a parliamentary democratic framework. It was a difficult combination. 4, land reforms within a democratic framework without coercion or violence, creating the first round of OBC revolution. It is here. We need to recognize that. 5, creating institutions and also anticipating the knowledge revolution in the 1950s. And 6, combining socialism, democracy and secularism all together. Not one at the expense of the other, but all of them together. And there, as I hinted, there may be some more work needs to be done. His failures need to be highlighted. Nobody should ever run away from the failures of our leaders. But these are also failures of Indian polity as a whole. Finally, Nehru inherited the idea of India. He did not create it. There was a very rich legacy before that. He inherited the idea of India, he developed it, he put flesh into it. It was a shell and he put plenty of substance into it. The idea has had a very interesting journey, not a very smooth journey. The idea seems to be encountering a rough terrain. As social scientists, we should closely observe this journey of the idea of India and the uneven manner in which it grows and falters and grows again and so on. But this idea is extremely crucial, and Nehru played an extremely, extremely important role in the formulation of this idea and in this development of this idea of India. I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much.